where the Japanese balloons, which the Japanese sent all the way over from the home island in Japan to land on the coast of America. Do you know that I think outside of one abortive single aircraft that flew over Oregon, I believe it was, a single Japanese aircraft that took off from a sub, one single airplane flew over American soil. He didn't do anything. He didn't fire on anything. He didn't blow anything up. He just made one quick sortie. I believe it was over Portland, or am I wrong about that? I know it was over Oregon. But one Japanese airplane that was flying from a sub flew over, he was a little seaplane, he flew over the coast of America up in the Oregon, Washington area, made one little sortie one night, looked down, took some pictures, and went skittering back. Now, that was the only real incident that we had outside of these wild Japanese balloons. Now, that is a gigantic technical problem to make a balloon that will go 9,000 miles by the Great Circle route, which is exactly what the Japanese did. And are you interested in how they did it? It's an interesting story to me from a technical standpoint, and no one could figure out how they were able to do it. And I had a friend who was assigned to this duty during World War II. His duty was to track these balloons, and he tracked thousands of them, and to be exact, or as exact as the War Department is about things like this, there were over 9,000 balloons that finally did reach American soil. How do you like that? And more than that, they have no idea, unless they can go back into the Japanese records and scrounge it out, how many thousands of them they loosed. But the idea was that a lot of them got here that they let go. There wasn't much in the way of failure. Now, what did these balloons do? I'm sure that you all know about this, don't you? It would make an interesting movie, wouldn't it? It really would. I can think of some great movies on this thing, because they had a couple of fighter squadrons that were based out on the West Coast whose only job was to shoot these things down. And during the war, it was a very closely kept secret. They did not want the Japanese to know how successful they were, because they were afraid that the Japanese would find out that they were really scoring with these babies, and they would put something big on them. And so at 2 o'clock in the morning, you know, you can imagine a primitive A-bomb landing on Portland that could cause a little excitement. But they kept it very, very secret. Now, here's the way the Japanese did it. I'll try to explain it to you as untechnically as possible. Now, you must understand, first of all, that a balloon rises with heat. The minute the sun hits a balloon, the balloon expands. Now, a balloon has to be built so that it's porous, so that if that balloon, and it will naturally expand, it has to allow for the escape of the gas, except if it doesn't, the balloon will merely explode. That's it. You've got a dud. So that means that with each expansion, you are going to lose floatability power. With each expansion, you are going to lose lift power. So what do you have to do? Now, it's a very, very difficult problem, because a 9,000-mile trip is going to take many days. There are going to be many suns. And that means that balloon is going to expand during the day and contract at night. Now, if a balloon expands during the day and lets a lot of its gas out, when it contracts at night in the cold air that it flies at, it's going to come way down. And in many cases, forget it. It's going to go all the way down. Now, the trick is to keep that balloon up. How do you do that? Well, you do that by an automatic system of ballast dropping, where the balloon drops its own ballast. So, in short, you create an automatic pilot for a balloon. Well, this was a fascinating device. On the bottom of each balloon was a long tube, and this tube had in it roughly 75 compartments. Each compartment contained a certain amount of sand or ballast of some kind. And each compartment had as its wall, if you can imagine a long can that's divided up into compartments, you know, just right down the line, this long can has like 75 separate little cans in it. Well, each little compartment, the wall of that compartment, had a tiny explosive attached to it. And each one of these compartments, now here's where you really get wild, each one of these compartments had also a tiny barometric device. that would only work when this barometric device is bared to open air. Now, this barometric device worked on actually worked on an altitude principle. So as if you go down lower, if you get into the Earth's atmosphere lower, of course, you know the pressure goes up. As you go higher, the pressure of air decreases. So each one of these little things was built to explode at a certain pressure. And so, say it's a daytime now. Your balloon is flying high. It's, say, at 25,000 feet. And they have to keep them very high so that they can stay away from fighters as much as possible, and also to get what is known as the jet stream. This is a very high altitude stream of fast air that moves over the Earth all the time in certain prescribed, always constant rivers, great rivers of air, you can call it, a jet stream. So they want to stay into that because they want this thing to carry them right into America. Well, the balloon would be up there. See, it's going fine now. Here it is. It's daytime. The sun is beating down, and it's high, and the balloon is expanded, and it's letting the stuff come out. The old air comes out of it. Well, all right, suddenly it gets night now, and it gets very cold. And the balloon contracts immediately, and down she comes. She comes down, 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 and suddenly this little barometric device on the bottom of the can is observing now that the air pressure is getting very dense. Down, 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 and it hits a certain point. It sets a tiny electrical switch goes off at that point. And boom! The bottom of this can blows off, and one container of sand is dumped. And the balloon goes, up she goes. Up, 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 and she hits that point again, and she lays in there, in her point now. Now, this is a very interesting point now that we were arrived at. She has lost just enough air, or gas, whatever gas they used, to maintain equilibrium. That means that each successive blow-off must be larger than the one before it to make up for the loss of gas between each day. You see what I'm saying? So the balloon finally arrives at the point of America. She has very little gas left and no ballast at all. And it is so delicately calculated that she comes right down and the last breath of this thing is landing in a forest in Oregon. Now, the idea of these balloons was to set forest fires. You know, wood is extremely critical during wartime, and particularly in those days when plastics were not as big a deal as they are today, and much of the plastic material was made out of wood in those days, wood derivatives and one thing and another. So the Oregon and the Washington woods were considered by the Japanese to be prime military targets. And so, night after night, these things were landing in the far northwestern woods in great sequence. Nobody would say anything about this because they really were. They burnt off countless acres of Oregon and Washington forest land and Canadian forest land with these things. And the way they would land and they would stay there for a certain length of time and drift down into a tree, and they would hang in the tree. And then, at a certain point, these things would blow up. They were time set. This was a time set deal. They knew how many hours it would take if it worked. And it would go, boom! And it had a vertical explosion, a horizontal explosion, rather, that would hurl thousands of tiny incendiary bombs in all directions, like from a pinwheel. Boom! It would go off. And it would set countless little forest fires. How do you like that? Another thing they did, once in a great while, was to, apparently there was no real pattern to it. They would send one over that had nothing on it, just a radio transmitter. And this was interesting. The radio transmitter, I'll give you the cue, it's all right. The radio transmitter, you're dealing with a pro here. The radio transmitter in these things would just send a continuous series of dots and dashes in a peculiar rambling fashion, so that the Japanese could track it to see how well they were doing, you see. It's sending back and forth, and it's measuring how well the balloon is working, you see. They would send one, it would be like a tracer in a machine gun, see. And this was what my friend was tracing. Countless things floating out over the Pacific, and he was tracking all these babies. And they were sending out this radio signal. Then once in a while, they'd include one that had an explosive in it. Just apparently at random. And do you know that the only civilians, in fact, the only people killed by enemy action on the continental United States were killed by one of these.